the 20th, 23rd day, ordinary time. My name is Diana Arcentales. Our interpreter today is Suzanne Barnard. Our mass intention, we pray for all our benefactors, guardians of this community, and for their families. We also pray for the healing and recovery of all our parishioners experiencing pain and illness, especially those undergoing treatment for cancer and those suffering from major surgery. We also pray for all our parishioners who are homebound. We pray for the intentions of those listed in our prayer list. We also pray for peace in Ukraine, Israel, Gaza, and the world. We pray for the souls in purgatory. We pray for an increase in attendance to our chapel and a renewed spirit of service to those who enter our doors. We also pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and religious life. Our theme is Be Opened. The readings for today's Mass are in the Heritage Missal, page 233. Our celebrant is Father Celsus Agust.
Stand as we begin our Mass with song. Our entrance hymn is in the Heritage Missal at number 451. All are welcome. 451.
Glory to God. bow your heads and pray for the grace that you may keep safe what God has planted in you. God of might, giver of every good gift, pour into our hearts the love of your name, so that by deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful care, keep safe what you have nurtured. And we ask this, Father, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, say to those whose hearts are frightened, be strong, fear not. Here is your God. He comes with vindication, with divine recompense. He comes to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened, the ears of the deaf be cleared. Then will the lame leap like a stag. Then the tongue of the mute will sing. Streams will burst forth in the desert and rivers in the steppe. The burning sands will become pools and the thirsty ground springs of water. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Responsorial song, praise the Lord my soul. Praise the Lord my soul.
Praise the Lord my soul.
The God of Jacob keeps faith forever, secures justice for the oppressed.
St. James. My brothers and sisters, show no partiality as you adhere to the faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ. For if a man with gold rings and fine clothes comes into your assembly, and a poor person in shabby clothes also comes in, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say, sit here, please, while you say to the poor one, stand there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions amongst yourselves and become judges with evil designs? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Did not God choose those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom that he promised to those who love him? The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
presidential election. So much is happening. We hear all types of news. CNN says one thing, Fox says another, and all types of news. And so we are confused. But when it comes to the church, we know that we always hear good news. And that's our consolation. Amen?
Amen.
And that is what the Alleluia reminds us. Don't worry what's happening outside the world. In here, there's always good news. Let's sing that one more time, reminding yourself that there is good news. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Amen. Yes, one more time. Alleluia. Good news. Alleluia. From the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Again, Jesus left the district of Tyre, and he went by the way of Sidon to the Sea of Galilee. He went into the district of the Decapolis, and people brought to him a deaf man who had a speech impediment, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. And so he took him off by himself away from the crowd. He put his finger into the man's ears and spitting, touched his tongue. Then he looked up to the heaven, groaned and said to him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. And immediately the man's ears were opened. His speech impediment was removed and he spoke plainly. He ordered them not to tell anyone, but the more he ordered them not to, the more they proclaimed it. They were exceedingly astonished. And they said, he has done all things well. He makes the deaf hear and the mute speak. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to
you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. He has done all things well. Hello. He has done all things well. Who is this who does all things well? Well, he's God. If we turn our Bibles quickly to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews reminds us clearly who this man is. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. Let's turn our Bibles. Hebrews 13, 8. Who is this man who does all things well? Anyone wants to read for us? Hebrews 13, 8. Do we have any Bibles here this morning? Yes, sister, read for us. Hebrews 13, 8.
Jesus Christ is the same.
Oh, Jesus Christ is the same
yesterday,
today,
and forever.
And forever. Amen? He's the man who does all things well because he's a perfect man. Who he was yesterday, who he is today, and who he shall be tomorrow is always the same. Amen?
Amen.
And so we are dealing, my dear friends, with God who is perfect. He does all things well. When God created the heavens and the earth, what did he say? It was good. Because he does all things
well.
And then you see, we need to know that our God is not temperamental. A temperamental person is a moody person. And because someone is moody, you're not sure what to get. Isn't that true? You say, I wonder what mood he is in today. I wonder what mood. So you walk on eggshells. Isn't that true? When someone is moody, someone is temperamental, you're not sure what to expect. But not our God. Because our God is perfect and he does all things well, we know that he always does everything. He does exactly. So we always know what to expect. Amen?
Amen.
Absolutely. Amen?
Amen?
Come on, church. Amen?
Amen?
Yes. So we know what to expect this year. We know what to expect because God does all things well. The book of Deuteronomy tells us, let's go back to the Old Testament. Deuteronomy tells us, Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4. It tells us about the God that we're dealing with.
32:4. Somebody read for us, sister. You have it again. So we are talking about a God who does all things well. And because he does it well, it's very conspicuous that even the people who he interacts with sees the perfection of who God is, that they too cannot but exclaim, my goodness, he does all things. Wow. He does all things well. Because he's the same God, a perfect God. When creation was made, he says it was very good. God never makes anything that is evil. Hello? So God doesn't make crap. He doesn't make rubbish. God makes all things well.
Carry this for the mic to record.
Yes, sister, read first. So look at this in Deuteronomy 32:4. What does it say?
The rock.
The rock.
How faultless are his deeds.
How faultless are his deeds. How perfect are the deeds of God. I didn't hear the amen.
Amen.
Continue.
How right all his ways.
How faultless, how perfect, thank you, sister. How perfect is God. And so in God's perfection, you are part of it. Don't leave yourself out. Hello? You are part of the perfection of what is. I'll tell you something. When you were created, you know what God said about you? When he created you, he says, I'll never make another one. Hello? You didn't hear that. Sister, when God made you, he says, I'll never make another one. That you are so perfect that God says, I'll never make another one. Woo! If that doesn't get you excited, nothing. But you see, the world outside there want to tell us that God didn't do it right. So they want to change us. They want to make us like God made a mistake. Well, I have news for you. God doesn't make mistakes. You didn't hear me? God doesn't make mistakes. And there's nothing to be changed when God made us. Because God does all things. He does all things well. And even you, when God created you, he did you well. And he's so much, you're so perfect in his eyes that he says, I'll never make another one. Isn't that amazing? There's never another me. There never will be another me. And God didn't have to make me twice. He just had to make me once. Because once is good enough. Because God can only do things well. Are you with me? You know when you, those of us who travel, when you re-enter the United States, there are three things they do. They take your passport, they look at it, they scan your passport, but that's not good enough for them. What do they do next? They look at your face. Photograph, that's right, but still that's not good enough. They're not surprised. You see, because someone can fake your passport, and someone can even fake your face, but there's a third thing that they do to validate who you are. What is that? Your fingerprints. No one can ever, ever copy your fingerprint. Hello? Only you have your fingerprint. Isn't that amazing? Because God does all things well. Hello? There can never be two different fingerprints. That's the beauty of God. That's the perfection of God. That's the might of God that we're dealing with today. A God who does things well. And in today's gospel, we are told that he restores, and every time we fall short, he restores us. You see, what sin does, sin makes us fall short of who we're supposed to be. Sin doesn't make you less. Sin doesn't make you more, it makes you less. Are you with me?
Yes.
Because God made us in his image and likeness. God made us to reflect who he is. And so God has high expectations of us. So when we sin, we fall short of the expectations of God, and so we become less. But that's not what the world tells us. Somebody say, That's not what they tell us. You know when you sin, when a man commits adultery, a woman commits adultery, you steal or whatever, you curse, and you know they console you, they put their hands on you. They say, that's okay. Okay, you know what they tell you? You're only human. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
That's what they tell us. When we sin, they tell us, that's okay. You're only human. But this is ludicrous. That's not true. We're not human because we sin. God didn't make us to sin, not at all. God made us in his image and likeness to reflect him. So I am human, repeat after me, I am human, not because I sin, but because I was made in God's image and likeness. I didn't hear you. because I was made in God's image. So when someone tells you when you sin that you're only human, tell them, no, I have fallen short. But I was made in God's image and likeness. What's wrong with you today? I'm not. Are you Catholics today?
Yes.
Just making sure. So we were made in God's image and likeness. And so we can look at this today's gospel from that perspective, from a spiritual perspective. That when we sin, we're in darkness because we've fallen less. But the God who does all things well wants us to be reinstated into the light of truth and into the light of his grace. And so what does God do? He looks at us and he speaks the word over us, Ephata, which is the very word we use at baptism. Every Catholic, when you were baptized, the priest spoke that word over you, Ephata, be opened. Get out of the darkness of sin. Get out of the darkness of ignorance and be open to the light of Christ. Be open to the light and love of God. Ephata, be opened. Be open. Are you with me? And so, my dear sisters and brothers, we need to know that God wants us constantly to walk in the light of love, in the light of truth, in the light of grace. Ephata, he says, be opened. Amen. Is that clear? And so when God speaks, he always speaks to renew, to reinstate, to restore dignity. Ephata. Because sin keeps us in darkness. Don't let them tell you sin because, well, you're only human. No. When I sin, I fall short. When I sin, I'm in darkness. And so I need the love of God, the light of God to speak into my life to say, Ephata, be opened, be restored. And notice in today's gospel, what does Jesus do? Well, they brought this man who was lame, mute, and so forth to him to lay hands. And what does he do? He takes him away from the crowd. I find this is amazing. Takes him away from the crowd. Why? Because he doesn't want the man to be a spectacle. He wants to preserve his dignity. Because, you know, the crowds would be cheering and laughing and would make him feel less. Because that's what the world does to us. Wants us to feel less. And so God does not want the man to feel less. And so he takes him away from the crowd and helps him to become more. And on a one-to-one, on a personal relationship, he opens his eyes and his ears and restores his dignity. Friends, that's what God wants for us. Not to be a spectacle in the world's eyes, but to regain our dignity. And our dignity is regained not by the world. Our dignity is regained, restored by a relationship with Jesus Christ. Am I speaking to somebody?
Yes.
See, the world, again, so the world always acts contrary. The world wants us to think that, well, if we have a Nike, if we have lipstick and all this good stuff, then we are better. No, we're not better because we have lipstick. Or we're not better because we have a Nike shoe. We are better because we were made in God's image and likeness. It's within. Our goodness comes from within. The greatness of who we are comes not from without, but from within. Amen? And so it is not what I wear that makes me. It is who I am that makes me. And my baptism, Ephata, makes me a child of God. That God has spoken the word of light and love over me. And that's what matters. And my dear sisters and brothers, if we truly believe this, how therefore do we respond? How do we respond? If we have come into contact with God, and we are now in a relationship with God, God expects us to be different. Notice when the man begins to hear and he begins to speak, what does he immediately do? He goes out to proclaim. He's excited. And he proclaims the good news of salvation. When we leave church this morning, when we leave church, do we talk about the message of salvation? I don't know. And one of the things that frightens me and hurts me is that you as Catholics, I'm not saying we, because I don't do that. You as Catholics, you come to Mass, you are fed on the Eucharist, you get a good homily, and after Mass, and that's okay.
And after Mass, you go to the diner for nice breakfast. You know, you go to a restaurant for nice breakfast. You just came from Mass, eh? And you go to the restaurant for a nice breakfast. And you know what? You're talking about everything except the Mass. Hello? Am I speaking to Catholics?
Yes.
Isn't that true?
Yes.
It's very true. We just came from Mass, and we had the rest 5 or 10 minutes later, and we're speaking about everything except the homily. Everything about the except the Mass. Can I do that? When the man was restored, when Ephata was spoken, when he was opened, his eyes were opened, and his ears were opened, and he was transformed, and he was restored, immediately he began to speak about Christ. Immediately he began to walk a different walk. Friends, the time has come, especially now, with all what's happening, with all the fighting and the division we see in America today over the presidential election. It's a frightening thing. We have to be the light for America. We have to be the hope for America. We have to be the voice that brings light to a world that is filled with darkness. We have to bring hope to a world that seems to be hopeless. We have to bring peace in a world that is torn by resentment and anger and division. We are supposed to be the light of Christ. And that's what happens when we come into contact with Christ. Am I speaking to somebody this morning?
Yes.
I'm wondering if I'm speaking to Catholics.
Yes.
Are Catholics? Bill says he's not even sure himself. Bill is not sure. And he's been here for how many years and he's not sure you're Catholics. Hello. So my dear sisters and brothers, that's who we are called to be. We are called to be catalysts for change in the world. Not them, but us. I love the translation that Bible verse, Matthew 5:13. You are the salt of the earth. You and I, we are the salt. And salt brings about change and preservation. And so today, as we talk about the perfection of God, remember that you were created within that context of perfection. When God made you, he says, I will never make another one. Just forget that. When God made you, what did he say? I will never make another one. So don't let someone make you believe you're not good enough. You are good enough. Am I speaking to somebody?
Yeah.
Don't let them tell you you're not good enough. You are good enough. Because when God made you, he says, I will never make another one. So I'm good enough. And I allow no one to say, I'm not good enough. I'm very good. Because not only did God say I was good, in the book of Genesis, when he created the heavens and the earth, he said it was good. When he created man, he said it was good. Because there is no adjective for very in Hebrew. So he said it was good. It was double good. So when God made me, he says, good, tells us. Good. You're very good. You're double good. That's who we are. So let us walk today with the dignity that is restored. And if it is not restored, my dear friends, because you're still in darkness, then go to the sacrament of reconciliation. Go to confession and get the word Ephata be spoken to you. Go to confession and be restored. That's where the action is, brothers and sisters. If you still think that you're less, if you still think you might be in darkness, if you still think that you're not good enough, then go to confession so that you may hear the word, sins are forgiven. You're restored. Go to confession and allow the word Ephata to be spoken over you so that you may be open to the light of love, the light of newness, the light of joy, the light of peace, the light of courage. Go and be restored. This is what God is asking of you today. Let us rise. My dear sisters and brothers, may I remind you, when we say the creed, you do not say, we believe. When you say the creed, you do not say, we believe. It is, I believe. It is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You are responsible. You have to say, I, not we. But you say the I within the context of the body of Christ. It's, I believe, but I pray the creed. Within the context of the body of Christ. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? Take your right hand and place it on your breast, because he does it well. And say after me, this is our faith. This is the faith of the church. And I am proud to profess it. In Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And this morning, as we bring to God our prayers and petitions, today is a feast of Our Lady of Charity. As we begin our petition, let's pray for the people of Cuba. I have some good friends there, and we know this situation in Cuba. Let us pray for its conversion. Let us pray for the people who are suffering in Cuba. And let us pray for healing. So let's say one Hail Mary in honor of Our Lady of Charity on her feast as we pray for the people of Cuba. Together, Hail Mary.
The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
For church leaders and all who are called to lives of service in imitation of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all touched by the tragic events of September 11, 2001, and may people of all nations feel renewed urgency to work for world peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have suffered loss from acts of violence, and for a world free from terror and war, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a time of enduring peace for our Jewish brothers and sisters in the Holy Land and throughout the world, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this community gathered here before you in faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And for all today's intentions that we've mentioned at the beginning of the Mass, we pray to the Lord. We pray in a special way today for all those who are celebrating their birthdays. We pray in a very special way for Ed, who's among us who's celebrating his birthday. We pray to the Lord. Good and gracious Father, on this feast of Our Lady of Charity, we bring to you all our prayers and petitions. Father, we know that you've made it, you've heard it, but we ask in your goodness and perfection that you answer all our prayers, for we've made them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Can you be seated as we continue our celebration?
You are there.
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father, the Almighty. May the Lord accept the sacrifice from my hand for the praise and glory of God's name, our good and the good of all His Holy Church. May this sacred offering, O Lord, confer on us always the blessing of salvation, that what it celebrates in mystery, it may accomplish power through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. For the perfection of God who does all things well, let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of your mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him, the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Sacrifice is going to take place right now. So listen carefully to the words and watch the actions of the priests. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending out your Spirit upon them like dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Jesus. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim
your death, O Lord,
and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Thomas, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember today the two students, two teachers who were killed in Atlanta, the shooting. Remember also our brothers and sisters who are falling asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God and Our Lady of Charity, with the blessed apostles, St. Jude, our patron saint, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Father, as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus the Christ.
For the kingdom of the Father and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever."
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you. Let us share a sign of peace with each other. The sin of the world, blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
weeks, 558.
I need you, absolutely.
and invite your parents to come forward. Lord, we only thank you for Patrick and Mary. Thank you for Patrick and Mary. As they review the words to God, we ask you to continue to bless them. Give them the grace to look to you to each other for strength. Let their lives be so strong that all those who are weak will be encouraged by the lives of you. And we ask this Christ, the Lord. For Christ and the church, may the Lord in his goodness continue to bless you both with his blessings. For what man has put together, let no man depart. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the daddy, this is Daddy's ring, he's given it to them after 52 years, Pastor Simon, right? So his blessing. Lord God, we ask to bless this ring as he had worn it for 52 years. May Patrick wear it, Lord, as a sign of his love for his wife. And may he continue that beautiful, faithful tradition that his parents has passed on to him. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may the journey lead them to their salvation and to that great kingdom in heaven. Bless the catechists, bless the teachers with love and passion. Bless them with zeal and courage. May they, by their lives and word, impart the message of salvation into the lives of these children. And may these children grow to respond to the word ever. And we ask this in Christ, our Lord.
Watching this Mass online. We would like to invite you to join us in person every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. here in Cooper City, Florida. Please remember to share this Mass with your friends on Facebook. By doing so, you help us spread the word about our ministry to persons who are deaf or disabled. We hope to see you soon. Save the date. Our 5K run, walk, and roll will take place on Saturday, October 19th. Registration is now open online. Please visit our website to register. Please check our bulletin board if you are interested in motorized wheelchairs. Important information regarding Amendment 4 is included in our bulletin. The bishops of Florida are urging all Catholics and people of goodwill to vote no on this amendment. This amendment has serious repercussions on the life of the unborn, the mother's well-being, and parental consent. Please review this information and let's build together a culture of life. Join us on our mission to spread hope. Become a missionary for our chapel by praying for us. Remembering us in your prayers at 3 p.m. during the Great Hour of Mercy. Inviting others, bring a friend to Mass, faith formation, or one of our events. Sharing the word, distribute our flyer to those interested in learning more or post it in the local community boards. Please join us for coffee and pastries after Mass. This is a good opportunity to meet your fellow parishioners and guests. All are welcome. We want to sing happy birthday to all our members who are celebrating a birthday this week, at home and here at church.
And stand, all the birthday people stand there.
Anybody?
There's one here, you stand, it's a birthday, birthday people, another one at the back.
Your St. Jude Chapel at Communities is in great need of your financial contribution. You can now send your weekly offering through the link posted in our official Facebook page or scan the QR code in our Sunday bulletin, which is posted online. We thank those whose love and generosity made possible that we can continue to open our doors to minister to all our disabled brothers and sisters. We wish everyone a blessed, safe rest of the week, and please remember to take a copy of our bulletin.
Finally, I notice we have a few visitors. All our first-time visitors, please stand so we can recognize you. First-time visitors, wow! Okay, let's all rise. Remember, while you're having breakfast or dinner, whatever it is today, talk about the homily, talk about the mass. Of course, those who are visiting, we have coffee and donuts at the back. And I will ask Pablo to send me the photographs I can send to you. The Lord be with you. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and give you.
Amen.
May the Lord let his countenance shine upon you and be gracious to you.
Amen.
May the Lord be kind upon you and grant peace.
Amen.
And the Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The last and good peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join our closing hymn number 569 in the Heritage Missal, Though the Mountains May Fall, 569.